Hello, hello. I don't know if you can hear and see me. I thought I'd take a minute today just to try and talk through a presentation about semiotics, medical education, and something I presented at a Humanities Day at Roehampton University, and it's going to have two functions. I'm going to talk a little bit about my interest in reforming medical education through the introduction of the humanities subject, as well as give me an opportunity to play around with the video and the format here to see if I can work something up that's of sufficient quality to be worth published on the internet. So this is a presentation I gave before, and I thought I'd reproduce it online, so anyone else who's interested in the works of Thurber von Oetskool, medical semiotics or medical education, or the I can put it the edu semiotics in medicine, might be able to watch it. The presentation is called Medical Semiotics and Medical Education. Can medical semiotics be part of the humanizing term in clinical education? Okay, so this will have a definition of what semiotics in medicine is, examples, some literature, a little bit of data from that analyzed, and a discussion. I'll give you a more in-depth video about what medical semiotics is, but this will have a little flavor of it. Okay, and maybe some tentative, of course. Okay, so predominantly, what is medical semiotics? It's the application of Persian semiotics in medicine. If you go back far enough in history, obviously Persia wasn't there, so it's the application of sign systems more generally. The word was really coined by Locke. So this primarily relates to symptomatology and also figures in the history of medicine. Some wonderful works by Volker Hess on that in particular, I'd say you should look at. There isn't really much about the sir in this, although you will see the word semiology in quite a lot of texts. It doesn't actually have anything to do with Saussure's work himself. So there we are, there's a picture of Aristotle, and I linked it to the other main thinkers. So we've got a triadic representation of Peirce for his sign interpreted object, and then we've got the Saussure and his signifier and signified model as well. Some primary semiotic modelling that goes into different bits of medicine. Obviously, I put Aristotle there because when you think about it, pre-technological foundations of medicine, when you couldn't look inside people, what you had was the clinical reasoning through logic, and you can find that in things like the text of Hippocrates and others, as well in the Hellenic period. So, Hellenic literature and medical semiotics, well, what is there? Well, when you look at Hippocrates' treatise, you can actually see him doing diagnoses. Again, I put the airs, waters, and places ones in there, for example, also naturally French reductions as well. They give nice little vignettes of clinical cases where you can see how we use reasoning and logic to come to conclusions about medical cases. There's one about breast cancer, for example, that I remember reading, and you can retrospectively now in our modern age see how good he was at deducing conclusions with nothing more than logical procedures to go from. It's quite interesting to look at if you ever get the chance. Okay, and he's still relevant really because you can look at some of the reforms brought into medicine by Sir William Osler, for example, a great medical reformer. You should definitely try and go and wait and read his work. But he was influenced by Hippocrates as well, about his humanistic approach to medicine that he thought should be reintroduced from a less technological, technocratic point of view that the subject has kind of left itself slipped into in various points recently. Not without mentioning Galen as well, if you want to connect medicine to semiotics, there's a wonderful chapter in a work by Thomas Seebach in his book Global Semiotics, which is called Galen in Medicine. I suggest you dig that as well. Obviously, Galen the Roman, following on from Hippocrates, also interesting approaches to semiotics and how can medicine. Okay, so if we come up to something a bit more current, around the 1800s, you do find lots of references to semiotics and medicine. Again, we're still I would say, before the technological revolution in medicine became effective. So you've got this work such as, I don't know, Semiotik und Diagnostik der Klinischen Krankheit. So, you know, the Semiotics and Diagnostic of Childhood Diseases, it's a Russian work, the translation into German. There's works on obstetrics for people like Kufland from 1823. Again, we've got another paper there from Becker about semiotics in relation to cardiology. Zur Physiologie und Semiotik der Herzenfähigkeit. German's awful. My German's awful. Again, you can see it wasn't an absent thing, so there is some historical literature about this. What I wanted to talk to you today really is how medical education could be reformed from a humanistic perspective by looking at some of the unknown works in German by a man called Thurs von Uxkull. He was probably one of the most important people in the history of psychosomatic medicine, if I dare say so, but he was also the semiotician, and he was the son of perhaps more widely known Jacob von Uxkull, who invented Umfeld theory and was also biologically inclined. You could say he was almost a crypto-semiotician, I think, as some have referred to him as well. There's a few references to some of von Uxkull's work. He was his son. Okay, so what is contemporary literature on medical semiotics, or what we might call more simply sign system studies in medicine? You may not think there's a lot. Actually, I think there's more than you may realise. So, for example, I'm going to outline a few, some general issues in medical semiotics. I took out a whole load of papers there. You see a Seebach reference at the bottom, some more books cool, but some other papers there by Hess or Nessa. John Nessa's paper is excellent, by Eugene Bayer too at the front. Staniano on the top, 1979. There's also quite a lot of other things. So you can look at neurolinguistics, there's some semiotics and neurolinguistics papers. Aphasia, so lack of speech, dementia, neurosemiotics covered by Favaro. There's quite a lot in psychiatry, as you might imagine. But then that brings in other semiotic theories beyond persons. And this list is going to be more extensive, so you've got, you know, suicide diagnosis, you jump down to homeopathy, HIV, schizophrenia, prescription of medicine, as well as, so it's got the next one, e-health, more modern contemporary topic, Williams syndrome, so a specific condition, immunology, and again quite a lot of symptomatology. Again, recognition of signs and symptoms is quite naturally well related to identification in symptomatology and etiology. I may not put up all of the references at the end, but if you put the names into Google, you have a good chance of finding them, or at a later date I might have. So what is the humanizing term in medicine, in terms of us who want to reform medicine in a more humanistic way? In Western medicine, some of the dominant models have been the biomedical model, naturally based on clinical trials. The problem was it tended to produce doctors that were a bit mechanistic, robotic, and didn't really factor in the emotional, cultural things in medicine that you have to be good at dialogue with your patient, speech, understanding them from an emotional, sympathetic point of view. So, okay, so rationalist approaches in medicine have been contested as well, and even when I talked about Osler earlier, he talked about medicine in this kind of Hippocratic way, where he said the practice of medicine is an art based on science. So you're really meant to be biomedical scientist and also a humanist in synchronicity to be a good doctor, was his argument. And I think we lost that humanistic touch in medicine from the turn of the 19th century onwards. It's been tried to be reintroduced. Again, so this movement reappeared in the 1670s in America, and I would say the medical humanities movement itself in the UK really had its roots in Glasgow in the 1980s, and also in Peninsula Medical School in around southwest England. Up to the point where, 1993 report from the General Medical Council, who's one of the statutory regulators of doctors in the UK, started to recommend the incorporation of medical humanities modules in its guidance, and also, medical sociology, and just taking language courses, for example, in its guidance, which is called Tomorrow's Doctors, first written in 1993, now on a subsequent version. So that's the guideline for doctors in the UK, which now we kind of recognise that there was a bit of a deficit in the humanism that medicine really used to have and should have again, and that was recognised in the statutory literature of doctors. And this generally was embodied in what we call special study units, or electives more generally, or student selected units, where they're notary, so your function as additional courses, basically, or window dressing, unfortunately, as some people would call it, not necessarily even credited, depending on your medical school. So it's there, but it's not at the centre. From 2013, the best references data I could come up with for this, that out of the 32 UK medical schools, about 30 of them offered medical humanities modules. So there are some appraisals of what this subject area looks like and how medical humanism has tried to be reintroduced. It looks typically, courses look at the intersection between literature and medicine, history and medicine, narrative and medicine, etc., philosophy and medicine, and generally the two put together to help practitioners comprehend another side of the world that's beyond biostatistics. There's a reference to Norton there, who's been a pioneer in this. So, I thought as a lesser current in this literature, I'd talk about Thor von Uxkull and what we might learn from him. So I did this mainly by analysing some of his work, but as I said, Thor von Uxkull is the son of Jacob von Uxkull, and it really had an impact on the study of biosemiotics and psychosomatic medicine. It's a nice picture there for you, it's referenced. there he is with his father. So I noticed a small untapped source of literature, I think, in this that might be useful for medical humanities scholars or anyone that has an interest in those particular clinical education subjects and how they performed. So what I did was I went through all of the papers I could find that he wrote in English, so the title says Thor von Uxkull's Anglophone Publication, 69, and categorised them. So you see a nice chunk of psychosomatic medicine, 43%, another chunk of biosemiotics, 29%, and then 18% medical semiotics and some smaller segment clusters there. But if you look at what he wrote in, so again, figure says Thor von Uxkull's German publications, another large chunk of medicine, psychosomatic medicine, 45%. But then you've got something that isn't present in English language literature, which is clinical education. So weirdly, when you read his work in German, you get a whole other perspective to the tune of 12%. And I thought this would be really interesting for a man that was a semiotician, a doctor who was interested in a fairly popular and relevant subject in psychosomatic medicine, what he might have to say about education, really. So here I have some of the translations of his work. These are some of the medical education topics and medical reform papers he wrote about, which I think was particularly interesting too. I tried to translate some of them roughly for you. There may be some errors. We can look at them. There's one from about four or five from the bottom. Ein modern medizinisch Fakultät im Rahmen einer technischen Hochschule, a modern medical faculty as part of the teaching college. So these papers are interesting to see if we can get a semiotic perspective for reforming medical education. And I thought they were warranted further investigation. There you go. There's some more. If you want to read them, please pause it and you can go on and have a dig. See if you can get hold of them. If this is something you'd like to know more about, there you go. Right in the middle, medical studies reform. Reform the medicine studium. Okay, so Thor von Uxkull's work on clinical education is yet to really be explored in a semiotic context, but I think it might be there. Recent launches of the idea of education semiotics, or edu semiotics, sometimes called, means it might be a ripe time to explore this Uxkullian literature, I think, as an idea of like how we're going to take medicine in a more semiotic direction. Well, this might be a good place to start. Also, his father, naturally, his work on the world. You can see there's a strain about ethics in some of Thor von Uxkull's work too, and I thought that might dovetail nicely with the work of Susan Petrilli's work on semioethics. Also John Dealey, I think, fed into that partly as well. So that's really, I don't know if I want to go too much more into this. There are some structural problems about introducing humanities subjects into clinical education, attempting to modify the structures of medicine. It's tricky. I will skip through this, you can read them if you really want to. The main argument is that getting your subject taken seriously within the economic climate of medical school can be tricky. Personal opinion, of course. Okay, I won't continue more into that. So, what did I conclude out of going through all these effectively literature review of Thor von Uxkull's work? Well, within Thor von Uxkull's numerous works, there is a strand of literature devoted to clinical education, all of which is exclusively in German, and so it remains to be translated and introduced to the English-speaking world. Translating the titles of these works, you might have some ideas about talking about ethics too, or semioethics might be a route to introduce semiotics into medical school curriculum. Ethics is a big, big part of small group learning, jigsaw classes in medical school in the UK. The translation of the works themselves, so far, is in its infancy, and it's not really revealed so much insights. I was going to say, essentially, I've been slow to get through it, but hopefully I will at some point. It remains to be seen whether the whole body of work can be finally translated, and what insights this may produce as a way to feed semiotics back into medical education, so, and hopefully to add to the humanising term in medical education that's been going on since about the 1980s, so we can help to produce more rounded doctors who are, how can we put it, fit for medicine in the 21st century. And that's really all I have for you today. A quarter of an hour of me trying to introduce a topic. If that interested you, there's my work address. This is something I've slowly taken forward over a number of years, and I hope you enjoyed.